Here is an extra lesson for you online on the YouTube channel on the nature of the war. We're going to start with the Civil War armies, and we're going to talk about the most important thing you could notice about the American Civil War armies. They don't have a clue what they're doing. So the pre-war army was tiny. There's about 16,000 men. They're either in coastal forts or they're out in the, sort of the west, sort of patrolling the frontier, where they're trying to protect the settlers from attacks by Native Americans. But this is the kind of war that Americans have never fought before. It's massive pitched battles with thousands of men going into battle against each other. They don't know what they're doing. So that's the first most important thing to understand about the Civil War armies. We've got our two sides here. They're often known by their nicknames. This is the Union. We're not going to stop calling the North. We're going to start calling the Union now. And in all wars, they tend to give nicknames to the soldiers. Fritz and Jerry for the Germans. They called the Vietnamese Charlie in Vietnam. This is Billy Yank over here in the Union Blue. This is Johnny Reb over here in the Confederate Grey, but the Confederates didn't really wear grey. They just wore whatever they could scrape together from home, really, whatever their wives would put together for them. They're going to meet on the battlefield, but the most important thing to understand about both these armies from both sections of America, the vast majority had zero military experience. The most common occupation for the boys who fought the war on the northern side and the southern side, the Union and the Confederacy, was that they were farmers. And the first time some of these guys discharged their weapon was in the face of the enemy. It was so tricky to train them up and give them the ammunition on time. They don't know what they're doing. I'm going to show you an example of how a Civil War battle might have looked through a cracking film, which is called Glory. Here's a 2-minute clip. It's going to tell you loads about how the war was fought. It's going to surprise you a little bit because it looks like they don't know what they're doing at all. Here we go. Thing to look at, isn't it? Right, so you've got a sense there of the chaos, of the carnage of an American Civil War battle. Some of you guys might have noticed Ferris Bueller there leading the Union troops if you're an 80s fan. Some of you won't know what I'm talking about. I'm going to show you that film next year in the upper sixth. But you would have seen most of those soldiers carrying this weapon here. This, the typical weapon they have is the Springfield rifled musket. both sides. It's most common for troops on both sides to be armed with this. And the most important thing to note about the rifled musket, these are the 1860s we're talking about. The tactics they're still using are really from the 1810s. So the tactics are from the Napoleonic era. But the weaponry has moved on. The weaponry is now more advanced. A rifle is a weapon which has grooves down the barrel. And so when it fires a bullet, which you can see down here in this corner, these are the most common types of bullets they fire. So this is the mini ball, named after Claude Monet. Mini ball. They call it. It's not a ball at all, it's like a conical, it looks like a modern day bullet, doesn't it? And you can see the grooves in that bullet as well, which means that when the mini ball is fired from a rifle, it spins. And if it spins, it's going to be more accurate and it's going to go further. So they could be accurate up to 600 metres. I mean, very, very few people could actually hit someone at that range. It's hard to see someone at that range. But the rifles are a massive step forward compared to the rifles in they weren't using rifles, they were using muskets, smoothbore muskets in the Napoleonic era that people would say, you know, you had to be like 80 to 100 paces away from somebody to use. So it's a lot more deadly, the American Civil War, because of the accuracy of the rifles. I could try and talk you through how it's fired. That's not going to be very effective. I'm going to give you an expert to see how you fire a Civil War weapon. You'll see how complicated it is and how long it takes. Here we go, another little clip coming up. Ready? Bear with me. Here we go. Let's fire a Civil War rifle. Let's go.
Load it 9 times. Load. Handle. Cartridge. Tear, cartridge. Charge, cartridge. Draw, rammer. Ram, cartridge. Return, rammer. Prime. Ready. A.
Okay. Well, there's a whole world of guys out there who will be prepared to dress up in Civil War dress and show you how to fight the American Civil War. Maybe you guys can take that up as a hobby and be one of them. You will have noticed as well the weapons that they're using for close combat on the end of their rifles are the bayonet. Not many people get that close, and there's not that much hand-to-hand fighting in the American Civil War compared to previous wars in Napoleonic times. So they don't tend to use those because the rifles are so good and so deadly at range. These are foot soldiers we're talking about. They are infantry, is what you call foot soldiers. Guys without horses. There are two main formations that they use. This, you can see them marching in a column. That tended to be when how you would get to places and how you would move around. It's narrow, thin and long. Whereas when you get onto the battlefield, you deploy into a line. Two or three soldiers deep, very long and wide to maximise the number of soldiers who can fire their weapon at the enemy. And when you have a volley from soldiers in line at troops approaching you from 80 to 100 sort of paces away, which is how close they got, it was absolutely deadly. That's the problem. That's why the casualty rates are so high, because they're fighting a fairly modern war with industrially produced weapons that are very accurate compared to the weapons were there 50, 60 years ago, but the tactics haven't moved on. And that's infantry. Watch some films. Go and watch this film. Go and watch this one. You could watch Glory, I'm going to show it to next year. Go and watch Gettysburg, Bill. I mean, it is 4 hours long, but what a treat that is. And you'll see a bit more detail about how American Civil War battles were fought. There are other elements to the armies that we're talking about. There are the artillery. That's big cannons. really, artillery. You can see up here what we call a field gun, because it's taken onto a field, it's towed around by horses. It's not massive, you get much bigger ones. Certainly in the First World War, you get much bigger ones than this. Artillery is a massive killer in the First World War. It's really not nearly as big a deal as that in the American Civil War. So at the beginning of the war in 1861, they only have five 12-pounder, this is a 12-pounder up here, 12-pounder, they call them guns, they're big guns, in the whole of the army. That's going to increase massively. What I'm trying to show you is that artillery doesn't play as big a role as you might expect it to play. It could fire possibly twice a minute, but they're going to run out of ammunition very, very, very quickly. Up to two rounds a minute. Anyone with a musket who's trained and can hopefully cope with firing a weapon in the face of battle, a good soldier, a trained soldier, would fire three rounds a minute with a musket or a rifle. It's more complicated to load the artillery. It takes about six to seven men. You are not going to find artillery playing as big a role as you might expect in this war. I will give you one battle as the exception where artillery is going to play a massive role, and that is the Battle of Fredericksburg. Okay, that's the exception that proves the rule of artillery being devastating. They do fire different types of shot, which you can sort of see some examples of down here. There is solid shots, just a massive ball of lead that can blast through people. And there is some early forms of explosive shot where you could fill it with high explosive in the middle and it would shatter. This is what you call canister. Canister, it's like a shotgun shell. So filled with lots of little balls. Shrapnel is how you guys might sort of understand this. And it would be fired from close range. This was long range, that was close range. If you got up to artillery piece at close range, it could annihilate lots and lots of people with the use of canister. But we don't see it generally winning battles. It's an infantry war that's fought by thousands of men on foot, trying to shoot the other guy before he shoots you. You will see a tiny bit of this in the clip for glory. You might have seen these guys. Blokes on horses we call cavalry. Key advantage of cavalry is their speed, is their mobility. They are the fastest thing on the battlefield, the cavalry. You can see a cavalry battle start here. You can see guys charging into combat there. What you mustn't get confused about with cavalry in the American Civil War is they're not really decisive on the battlefield. Not much of a battlefield role. I did consider doing my dissertation at university on the role of cavalry in the American Civil War. I never did it, one of the great regrets of my life. They don't really fight in the huge pitch battles and do cavalry charges the way you would have seen in the Napoleonic era 50, 60 years before. Their key roles, therefore, are reconnaissance. They're scouts to find out where the enemy is, they find out how far the enemy is away, they try to find routes for their army to follow, they try to cover a retreat, and screen in advance. There's some fancy military terminology for you, but they're normally operating ahead of the army, further away from the army, and they're gathering information for their commanders. In general, the Southern cavalry is seen as the far superior element at the beginning of the war. That's going to change a little bit by the end of the war, but why not? I've got another 40 seconds or so before my YouTube 15-minute limit runs out, so I'll tell you some really famous cavalry commanders. A bloke called Jeb Stuart for the Confederacy is one very famous cavalry commander. Another bloke, he's in the Eastern Theatre. Another bloke in the Western Theatre, it's called Nathan Bedford Forrest. We're going to learn about him next year. He's a Confederate as well. Two famous cavalry geniuses who are very successful in their trade. That advantage the Confederates have is basically wiped out by the end of the war. But we're not going to talk about cavalry that much in the infantry battle. So there's a quick introduction for you. Go watch some films and find out about the most devastating war that Americans fought in their history. Don't forget, we're talking about 620,000 dead. That's Union and Confederate.